through all of the beautiful Tesla arms, including the billet uppers. This is the bearing conversion for the caster arm. It actually gets more track width. This is the offset side spacer and bearing conversion for the inboard front lower control arm. And this is the offset coilover bearing conversion for the coilover lower mount in the front lower control arm. That offsets that mount for more steering angle clearance. This is the Tesla Model 3 caster arm bearing conversion. And this is the offset version of that. So this would allow you to make track width changes in the case of our drifting agenda, or you can make caster changes here. So this is the new bearing conversion for Tesla front lower control arm, coilover lower mount. And I just got this one taken apart so that you can see all the components. You can see that it's serviceable. So the bearing will install into the housing, and we used green Loctite 680 bearing mount compound on there. And then there's a lock ring, which we put red Loctite on there, thread locker. And then we actually have our lock ring tool, which helps tighten that guy down. So slips into those slots, tighten with a wrench, let the Loctite dry. And that's all there is to that. Then when you go to put it in, you're gonna slip in your bearing side spacers. Got some heavily offset side spacers right here. And basically what that does is that gets your coilover lower mount away from the double pivot arms when we have our modified knuckle in there. Super angle knuckle makes those arms swing around a lot on that double pivot setup. And then we have some conventional side spacers for people that don't care about adding steering angle. So we get the OEM Tesla Model 3 front lower control arm. And with those aftermarket bushings in there, we took out the stock one. Now, I was so surprised because I actually bent the taper pin when I went off track. So other than the alignment being jacked, and it just wasn't really obvious why, this inboard joint that is mounted in rubber, let me line up this piece of paper. You can see just how much this inboard mount got tweaked. And I'm really surprised about that because I thought it was pretty beefy. So that's the straight side. That's the tweak side. So it's a good thing that we're building way thicker parts because it doesn't have that rubber cushioning inside here because we are spherical bearing, but the way that will increase response is gonna be absolutely phenomenal for the front end of the car, not just for the driver, but also for the lifetime because these things wear out super fast. Even if you don't go to the track. So you can imagine with those extra forces that drifting and track time is bringing the car, you're definitely gonna wanna go spherical bearing. Coming in at 8 millimeters. And then I just wanted to show you how thick our aftermarket bearing side spacers are. That's coming in at 14. So way thicker on our bearing side spacers. And actually look at the size of this bearing. That's a 22 millimeter ID bearing, and it's bigger than anything that we've ever used on any car application. But clearly, just given how this car has the ability to tweak those OEM parts, it's definitely needed. What we see right here is offset bearing side spacer. So we've got the straight ones for people that don't care about getting extra track width, negative camber, or angle clearance for drifting. We've got an offset one with some extra hardware. Because of the thickness difference, we supply hardware that can actually use all the threads in the car and go through this thicker piece. You can really easily see the difference between the offset and non-offset type. So we've got this that we're testing out in heat-treated, non-heat-treated versions of that. Hopefully you guys are looking forward to testing on track just as much as I am. I'm gonna abuse this stuff. We're building a catalog here of amazing parts. Thanks for following. That was 6858 inside of the 8070, but what we really needed was that 6858 to be in the 8272. That's the big kind of air gap. Not get this guy stuck. What we got here is we have Tesla's front lower control arms, which are absolutely identical for driver and passenger side. So left and right are identical. They have an easy chamfer right there on the edge on one side, and then it is absolutely sharp on the other side. So since we have a strategy about what side we want to put our bearings flanges on, we're definitely going to want to take care of any of the sharp sides so that we can have a good lead in and a successful installation. Use the Debur tool, and we're gonna knock off that sharp edge. Nice and easy. Definitely has a way more defined chamfered edge there. We wanna put our bushings in from the front.
Yeah, so right. There's a factory lead-in on this as well.
There. And you can actually see it. I'm gonna face the light. So those are the factory lead-ins on the left arm. And then these are the ones that we just did with the Debur tool on the right arm. So those are a little bit smaller, but they'll do the same thing. Yeah, so we're just gonna mark these arms so we can keep track of them. So left and right front. And then now that we have our front side established, we're gonna talk about the coilover lower mount, how it has these two little flanges on there. They need to avoid some of these features that run right in close to the bore for that bearing housing. So we're just gonna like split the difference between those obstacles. And the way that we can look at that is just by maybe like flipping them over first.
Yeah, so first what we'll do is, let's just make a mark on one side on the center here. Okay, so if we flip him over, what we want to pay attention to is the gap here and the gap here. So we definitely don't want this flange to ride on this raised section.
Right, you just want to split the difference so that there's like an even gap on both sides.
Yeah, even gap about right there. So now that we're happy with that position, I would transfer my mark onto the arm there. And then now when we go to press it, we're going to sight down from the bird's eye and kind of just line those up. And then we know that's where we want to press it in.
Right, so that'll be a good thing to eyeball after we put this in the freezer. We'll take it back out and we're going to send it before it warms up. Moving over to the other side.
Yeah, same thing, just pick any spot here, make a mark, and then we'll actually label these. So this is the right hand arm, so let's just label this so we use the right bushing in the right arm based on our reference mark. So put that on there, and just kind of split the difference there, about right there. And then now for this mark.
Okay. Nice. And when we get them out of the freezer, the sight line down and those two marks, we'll be good. So we just popped the bearings out of the freezer, got them in there for 45 minutes. Now Chris is just applying some grease. Grease is definitely going to help out with all of the scoring that happens when we press out the OEM bushings because it's aluminum on aluminum. So he's lining up his mark that we made earlier. Great. A little grease on the inside of the bore. And we're also getting it around the frozen bushing. And Chris is gonna line up his marks that we made earlier on the metal desk. And while looking straight down on it, I'll get it all aligned. And then counter them. We'll clean up some excess grease. Alright, so we got the front lower control arm inboard bushing out of the freezer. And this is gonna hook that up with some grease on the bores. Also on that minor OD on the frozen bushing. No alignment necessary. All right, so we got our next bushing out of the freezer. A little bit of grease in that bore. Deal with the scoring that comes with taking the OEM stuff out of there. This one's a little smoother than the other ones though, Chris. Or it still has that.
These are pretty galling. These are pretty scored. Yeah.
We got our little lead in to make sure that guy's straight. Should pop right in there. Should put a little bit more effort into that one.
Yeah.
All right, so we got our Tesla caster arms here. About how to mark these things. There's these little features that are bumped out. They're very square and it's all around the opening of those bushings. So what Cam did is he marked the left and right edges of those square features. And then we just put a mark on the center line of those guys. And then that'll correspond with marks that we will have lasered into the bearing conversions. And we'll also mark which side is top. So right here, we've got our arms marked with left hand and right hand. And there's a lead in. If we flip this guy over, you can see that the OEM bushing has this nice chamfer to slide in, but for us, we've got a sharp edge. So we're just gonna take the Debur tool and we're gonna run around that edge and make sure that we got a great lead in when we go to pop these bushings in. Any tricks on how that always catches on me, Chris?
This is the direction that you're pushing. So if it always catches right here because of the direction you're pushing, you could flip it and do another pass. Look in the opposite direction, usually.
Right on. So Chris is just grabbing the right-hand bushing out of the freezer, just because that's the arm that's closer to him right now. You see that we got our marks on there on both the arm for those square features, and we get our marks on the bearing conversion housing, and those will be lasered in there. So after he gets the bore and the frozen bearing housing both greased up, then he's gonna have to sight line down directly from the top to make sure that the marks on the bearing housing and the marks on the arm are totally on center. And for our purposes, that is to make sure that we are getting a track width increase, not a caster change. these are. I'm gonna give it like a little micro tap so it doesn't walk. There you go. Is it fairly well lined up? Didn't shift too much, Chris?
Not too bad. When I sight lined it, these marks wouldn't line up exactly perfect, so I split the difference. So they were both, okay. They both wanted to be on this side of this mark. So I'm really looking at the opposite ends. Pretty close there, and then this one always almost looks perfect once I split the difference between those.
I imagine that a very slight amount of rotation that probably won't affect the alignment setting as much as like the tolerance on the subframe as mounted to the chassis, because both of those things are just so wonky. Looks great. Thanks, guys.